So this is a film about what happened to the CCP, the Chinese Communist Party, after the White Terror, after the GMD had turned against them in 1927, and after Chiang Kai-shek had used violence and killed so many members of the CCP and their supporters. There were various attempts by the CCP to fight back against the GMD, as you would expect. For example, between August and November 1927, Mao Zedong, who was a leading member of the party, he led a series of uprisings against the GMD that are known collectively as the Autumn Harvest Uprising. But these were all unsuccessful. And as a result of them, by the end of the year, he and his followers had to flee to the mountains of Jiangxi. That's J-I-A-N-G-X-I. It wasn't the only uprising. There were also uprisings in Nanchang and in Guangzhou. But none of these uprisings were successful. And by the end of the year, the CCP was a pretty sort of scattered and broken force. And in 1928, Chiang Kai-shek went on to complete the Northern Expedition, doing a deal with the new warlord of Manchuria, Zhang Xuliang, and establishing a national government that governed China reasonably effectively until 1949, actually. Now, I mentioned Mao Zedong. He was one of the leading members of the CCP, but he wasn't the only leader of the CCP. And his group that fled to the mountains of Jiangxi were not the only group within the CCP. There was also a group of them that stayed in the cities and operated secretly, operated covertly, trying to keep away from the GMD. There was a major base, for example, in Shanghai. And that's where the leadership of the CCP were based. And the leading members there were Chun Duxu, who was the guy, along with Li Dejiao, who had initially set up the Communist Party in 1920-1921. And another guy called Zhou Enlai, Z-H-O-U-E-N-L-A-I. Now, he'd been at the Whampoa Military Academy and had a political job there. He now became pretty much the leader of the party, based in Shanghai. There was another group of Communist Party leaders who went back to Moscow to seek instructions from the Soviet Union on what to do next. And this group are known as the 28 Bolsheviks, or the Returned Bolsheviks. And the leading members of that group were a man called Wang Ming and Bo Gu. So... And on top of those, there were also other rural groups of Communist Party across the country. So the party was very split, and it would be wrong for you to get the idea that Mao Zedong was the leader of the party and that they were all unified. As well as them being geographically split, they were also split over what to do next. They were split over policy. The major split, and I may be simplifying a little bit here, but the major split was between Mao, on the one hand, who thought that as China was predominantly a rural country, an agricultural country, and most of the population were peasants, Mao thought that the party should concentrate its efforts on spreading revolution amongst the peasantry and should try to enlist the peasantry, get them on board, and try and use them as the revolutionary force, the people who would carry out the communist revolution in China. But that was a diversion from how the Soviet Union saw a communist revolution coming out. The Soviet Union said that, according to Karl Marx, a communist revolution is carried out by industrial workers, the proletarian. And therefore, the Chinese Communist Party, if it wanted to carry out a communist revolution, should also try and inspire rebellion and revolution amongst the Chinese workers. The problem was there just weren't anywhere near as many workers in China as there were peasants. Something like 88% of the people were peasants, And the, you know, the vast majority of the Chinese people lived in villages. They didn't live in towns and cities. So you can understand, I think, Mao's thoughts that they should concentrate their efforts on the peasantry and in the countryside rather than to the cities. However, as the Soviet Union was kind of the communist inspiration and the kind of communist mothership, there were people in the Chinese Communist Party that thought you should, that thought the CCP should toe the line, and that was the thinking of those members of the CCP that were based in the cities. People like Zhou Enlai, people like Cheng Duxiu, and it was the thinking of those that went back to the Soviet Union to get instruction. People like Bo Gu and Wang Ming. So, the party was geographically and politically split by the end of the 1920s. And in fact, the membership numbers sank quite dramatically, and they were down to about 10,000 members by 1928, from a high of around about 60,000 members in 1925-26. Nonetheless, I'm going to talk now about Mao's group. Mao and others went to a province called Jiangxi. They went to a mountainous area, and basically they went there to escape from attacks from the GMD. And while they were there, they established what they called the Chinese Soviet Republic. Now, Soviet is the Russian word for council. And what Mao and his followers were doing was attempting to set up a communist-style government in the province of Jiangxi. He wanted, the whole purpose of this was to, you know, govern the area and use it as a base from which to spread revolution throughout China. And his overall aims were to get rid of the imperialists in China, get rid of the foreigners, and also to get rid of the GMD government, which he saw as being headed by Chiang Kai-shek, as being corrupt and brutal and authoritarian, wanted to get rid of it from China. So while he was there, Mao Zedong formed a Red Army. Now, he didn't do this on his own. He did it with another communist leader called Zhu De. That's spelled Z-H-U-D-E. And they formed an army to defend their base, which they had to do because the whole time it was there, it was being attacked by the GMD, by Chiang Kai-shek and his allies, who wanted to drive the communists out of China. They basically wanted to complete the white terror that had started in 1927, because Chiang continued to see the CCP as a threat to his regime. But the Jiangxi Soviet managed to survive. And in the years that they were there until 1934, so they were there for around about 5 years. In the years that they were there, they recruited lots of peasants into the party. They studied peasant life. And they implemented some policies that they thought would be of benefit to the peasantry, like redistributing land, for example, which basically means that they took land from the rich landlords and they gave it to the poor peasants. Now, unsurprisingly, that was pretty popular with the peasantry, who were the lowest, poorest class in China, but not so popular with the landowners and the upper classes. Those people were branded as class enemies, and they were stripped of their land, and they were often tortured, imprisoned, or even executed. But aside from that, there was also some experiments with social reform in the Chinese Soviet Republic. For example, there were policies to improve the rights of women. Arranged marriages were outlawed. Divorce was made easier. Women were given equal rights as men and allowed to participate in decision-making in local villages. There were programs for literacy and education provision. So in many ways, you know, the Chinese Soviet Republic introduced some quite progressive policies for the benefit of the local population. But It wasn't all kind of sunshine and positivity in the Jiangxi Soviet. Mao was also incredibly ruthless and suspected that spies had infiltrated his region, his Soviet Republic, and used incredibly brutal interrogation and torture techniques against anyone he suspected of being a spy. Anyone he suspected of being a spy for the GMD, or being members of the Communist Party he felt that didn't agree with his way of how things should be done. And some estimates say that several thousand people were killed in this process of Mao purging, i.e. getting rid of anybody he thought was suspect. This happened particularly in March 1930 in what's become known as the Futian Incident. But as I say, all the whole time that Mao and Zhu Dei were in Jiangxi, they were under attack from the GMD and their forces. Chiang Kai-shek launched a series of what were known as encirclement campaigns. And essentially, his military tactic was to encircle the Jiangxi base area and strangle Mao and the CCP out of the area, stop any supplies getting in and stop them moving around. It got so bad that by 1934, Mao and others realised that it was time that in order to survive, they would have to leave the Jiangxi base area. I should say, by the way, that by 1933, the other factions of the party, those that had stayed in the cities and those that had returned to Moscow to get instructions, they'd all converged in Jiangxi because it was the biggest, most successful Soviet republic in the country. There were other smaller Soviet republics, but this was the biggest, most successful one. So the main leaders of the Communist Party were all in Jiangxi by 1934. Now, in October 1934, that leadership decided that in order to survive, they would have to abandon the Jiangxi base area. And they set out on a march. What's gone down in history and is now known as the Long March. Some historians have said this is the most extraordinary march in human history. The party didn't necessarily have a destination in mind when they set out. They just knew that they had to leave Jiangxi in order to survive. They ended up marching for over a year. They walked over 6,000 miles and walked in a huge arced route around China up into the northwest. They had to cross mountain ranges, they had to cross rivers, they had to cross frozen swamps. They endured incredible hardship along the way. And the whole way along the march, they were fighting battles with the GMD, who were trying to kill them off, and with warlords, who were also suspicious of them. But they also, along the way, did deals with various warlords who were anti-Chiang Kai-shek and the GMD. And they also took particular care to treat the local populations of the villages and towns and cities that they came across with respect. And so they managed to attract some supporters and make quite a good reputation for themselves along the way. But around about 100,000 communists left the Jiangxi base area in October 1934, and about 80% of them died on the route. That's how hard the march was. There was a shortage of food, they were fighting battles along the way, they were living in incredibly hard conditions. And it was a serious, you know, the combined effect of all of that led to a serious depletion of numbers in the Communist Party. Also, along the way, they held a conference in the town of Zunyi, Z-U-N-Y-I. This was in March 1935, and this was where they came together to discuss how the march was going, future strategy, to reflect on what had happened to them. And at that conference, Mao Zedong managed to win a number of key votes blaming other leaders in the CCP for their misfortunes up until that point. and also winning key votes on what should happen next about concentrating their efforts on the peasantry and where they should go in terms of the Long March. And historians now see that Zunyi conference in March 1935 as a key turning point in Mao's rise to the top of the party. He still wasn't the leader of the party, you shouldn't get that idea, but he was now one of the strongest members of the leadership group that still included others like Zhao Enlai and Zhu Dei and others. In fact, all the leading members of the Chinese Communist Party, all the people that dominated Chinese government from 1949 to 1990 were survivors of the Long March. Not just Mao, who was leader of the country until 1976, but Deng Xiaoping, who was leader of China into the 1980s. He was a veteran of the Long March, and so were other leading members, like Peng Duhuai, the army general who led the Chinese assault against the Americans in Korea. He was a veteran of the Long March. Lin Bao, another leading general. Liu Shaoqui, who became prime minister of the country into the 1960s and 70s. All the leading members of what was to become the People's Republic of China were veterans of the Long March. And Mao himself claimed that the Long March was an incredible propaganda victory for the party. It showed to the world how heroic members of the party were. He painted it in epic terms. It was an epic battle against the GMD and against the elements as well. And it showed the just incredible determination of the CCP to survive. And I think he's right. If you're prepared to march for over 6,000 miles for over a year and endure those incredible hardships just to survive as a political group for the things you believe in, then there is something incredibly profound and strong about that that can be used as a, you know, as propaganda for your party. Because let's face it, they could have all chucked in the towel. They could have said, well, you know, is it really worth fighting for? Perhaps we can join the GMD. Or they could have just, you know, given up on their politics, but they didn't. They, you know, they fought to preserve the things they believed in. Anyway, by October 1935, they'd arrived in this remote northwestern Shanxi province, that's spelled S-H-A-A-N-X-I, and they then went about setting up a new base area, and this was to become their base area then for the next 12 years. They were in Shanxi province from 1935 to 1947. And the city of Yan'an, spelt Y-A-N-A-N, or sometimes you see it spelt Y-E-N-A-N, became the capital of the new base area for the CCP. They were much depleted when they got there. As I said, only something like 20% of the original Long Marchers survived, but the CCP's fortunes were to undergo a dramatic change and a dramatic improvement at the end of 1936, when, incredibly, despite the GMD attacking them for the past, 9 years or so, they entered into a second united front with the GMD. This time, it was a united front against the Japanese rather than against foreigners and warlords. And the fortunes of that second united front and why they went into it and why they felt they needed it for to fight the Japanese will be the subject of a later film. Bye for now.